G'day, welcome to the Bronia and Bayswater Community Church of Christ. Here we seek to love God and people as Jesus did. Here we want to connect people from the crowd to the core in Christ. And we want to grow through sharing the good news of Christ with those we live, laugh and work with. We hope you find this message uplifting today. Have a great day.
Part of my own journey around being a follower of Jesus is that journey around naming some of those areas of reconciliation in our world. And so as part of my journey, that's what I'm doing. Naming the parts of our world that need reconciliation. Friends, when was the last time you needed just a little bit of hope? What does hope look like for you? You know, in a time like this where there are loud voices, there is opinion-soaked media, mass digital connection paralleled with mass disconnection. What does hope look like for you? What about love? Divine love, caring love. What does that look like for you? Well, Jesus in John 13, he begins to talk and give the disciples a new commandment, one that would shape and mold the early church into being a revolutionary force that would make them stand out amongst all people. And in John 13, we see this. I'm sure you know this well. Let me give you a new commandment. Love one another in the same way that I love you. Love one another. This is how everyone will recognize that you are my disciples. And when they see the love that you have for each other. In other words, friends, let me be really clear here. By our actions, we will be known. By our works, we will be seen. By our love, our care, and all that flows from this love, that divine love, all the world will know that we are followers of Christ. Wonderful words. Powerful words. Difficult words. Because they come at a cost. Love can be a great way to start, but the difficulty can be when our desires can get in the way of the good words, the good fruit that God has in store for us. And so I pause here, hesitating whether it's helpful to name some of our own corporate sins. Even in our own country, there have been many times where love has not been our priority, but rather greed and hate and segregation, fear and power, spiritual abuse, spiritual control. Too often that has been our priority. Too often that has been our story. And perhaps it is important to name our own corporate sins, even if we didn't commit them. Why it's helpful is because it's a way around us confessing and dedicating our country once again to God's healing and reconciliation. Something powerful happens when we name the elephant in the room. Love is powerful. Love can transform. It can heal and mend. Love can restore and massage back to life, even the hardest of hearts. When Jesus is talking about love, he is using the divine, sort of metaphysical, highly relational version of love. He's not talking about the love that you and I know so well. He's not talking about my love for the Carlton Footy Club, though that could be somewhat deep at this point in time. It's a good year to be a Carlton supporter. It's a good year. Now, Jesus is talking about agape love. So let me just break this down a little bit. In the Greek translation, the word that Jesus is using here for love is agape love. There are a few different words for love, kind of going from a flame to like a fire, a huge bonfire. Jesus is talking about the bonfire. He's talking about agape love. Agape love is essentially beyond our understanding and our human minds. What a great way to start. We don't even understand it. But let me paint a picture for you. Agape love comes, it's fundamentally who God is and how God operates. Agape love is God's sole character. Agape love, it's creative, it's imaginative. It's sacrificial. It's all-consuming. Agape love is all-encompassing, full of compassion, and it is also highly invitational. It is the heart of who we are as God's people. It surrounds us. It molds us. These are the characteristics of God, the footprints in the sand. Agape love is God in full view for all to see. Agape love is so powerful and so important that it's mentioned over 200 times in the New Testament. It's important. It's important that we understand why this word is used so much. And so with this in mind, when Jesus commands his followers with this command, love one another. Love one another. By this love, all people will know who you are. You'll know who Jesus is. Why is that important? Well, because what Jesus is doing here is creating a beginning point, a fundamental basic point for who we are called to be. And if we claim to be followers of Christ, how do we work through life if not through this parallel lens? Love in the time of empire was difficult. In the time of Jesus, it was difficult. In the time of the early church was surrounded by cultures and religions that valued power, money, and status. Even within the rabbinic tradition, and we see Jesus say a lot about the rabbinic tradition. He has a lot to say about corruption. Jesus has lots to say to the priests and the leaders in the temples. He has a lot to say, really critically here, about the ways in which the religious ruling class are operating within the churches. For the early church, they needed to move past some of these cultural norms and have a fundamentally different shape to how they operated from the temple and the synagogue. So you add to this the difficulties of being a faithful Jew in occupied territory by the Empire of Rome. You are told again and again through these subliminal messages that you don't matter. You don't matter. Caesar matters. Caesar is Lord. That's why the soldiers walk through the streets with their pomp and ceremony, power, control. Caesar is Lord. You don't matter. More work without straw each day produces, needing to produce more and more without much of what they have. It almost sounds like 2022 a little bit, doesn't it? Amazing. That is how the story comes alive when we see ourselves in the same story. And so the Apostle John is writing to the early church globally to encourage them in their faithfulness and discernment and love. And so it's early 90 AD, and John is the last surviving apostle, is in the final few years of his life. And this is almost like a last will and testament, if you will. If you come to the end of your life, what is the one thing that you need to share that is so important for you? What is the one thing that you need to share with the churches in the Mediterranean area? What is the one thing that you would say that is so important that you need to write this down? And so, friends, John begins here. 1 John 4, verses 7 to 12. John says this. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love amongst us. He sent his Son, his one and only Son, into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love God. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. What a powerful call to witness. What a powerful call to live as beacons of hope in a world consumed by darkness and confusion. Just as Jesus was sacrificed for us, a sign of agape love, a sign of the character of God, so too we are called to live as forever laying down ourselves for those around us. No longer do we live in an alternative, ego-driven, selfish, powerful, hungry way, but rather we live out of agape love. That's what we are called to do. And this is really critical. We are called to be in relationship with God in agape love, not just attendance love. As He loved us, so we are to live out of this love and His purpose for us when we are welcoming, inviting, including, and reconciling. So some practicalities here. Agape love does not place conditions. Does not place conditions on whether you are worthy of being loved. Because friends, this is important, and I've said it a few times, and I think it's always helpful to be reminded again and again. We are already loved before we even took a breath. Before we even confessed our sins to God, we were loved. Before we even gave a confession of faith or baptized or walked in the path of relationship with Jesus, we were already loved. So there's nothing really that can get in between us other than our own hearts. You are already loved. You are already loved. There is no way you can be both agape love in the church and not agape love on Monday. The idea here is we are showing agape love all the time in every part of our life, being consistent, faithful Christians, and not being different on a Monday because it suits us. By John's definition, if we live unevenly like this, we simply just don't understand who God is. We are called to be consistent. What John is on about at a fundamental level is Christians actually turning out when it matters the most and living that authentic life. And so a good example of this is the story of the Good Samaritan that is found in Luke 10. I'm sure many of you know this story, but let me recap in a short way. There was a Jewish man walking along the Jericho Road. The Jericho Road was a dangerous road. It was not known to be a safe road. It was a winding road that leads sort of all the way up to the city in some part of the hills. The Jericho Road had many turns in which one can hide. It is known to be a place of robbers and bandits. And so there is this Jewish man and he is walking along the road and he is attacked. He's beaten up, he's stripped of his clothes, he's left in the gutter for death. He's a bloody mess. He's left in a state in which you do not survive. It's not a good picture, is it? Not pleasant. So the story goes that a priest walks past this man. He sees him in the gutter. But for fear of blood, for fear of his own cleanliness, his own ability to participate in religion, he goes to the other side and he walks past. Then there was, of course, a Levite, a man from the temple. So too, this chosen man was worried about the laws of cleanliness, was worried about his own ability to be participating in religion. So he too passed to the other side of the road and kept on walking. To this end, it was a Samaritan who came to the man's aid. And just for context here, it's important for us to be reminded of who the Samaritans were. For Jesus is making a very poignant political point here. The Samaritans were a people group from the north. They were hated by the Jews and seen as outcasts and foreigners. The Samaritans were culturally rabbinic, but ethnically different. They couldn't worship in the temple. They were not welcome in Jerusalem. They were not welcome in the synagogue. They were seen as completely unwanted from that rabbinic culture. You are not allowed to be here. The Samaritans were complete outcasts. For us, if we want to contextualize this, because I think that's helpful, these people are our own outcasts within our own society. So I think about refugees or asylum seekers locked away in the Park Hotel for 9 years, people who are politicized, marginalized, so vastly separate and considered unworthy of rights as you and I are. This is Black Lives Matter stuff, if I can go there. pushed aside, marginalized, politicized, people who are not welcome simply because of who they are. So you see it in the Samaritan, you see the asylum seeker, the indigenous woman in prison. That took his oppressor, loved him, felt mercy on him. It is this person, the cast aside person, who took care of the Jewish man and took him to safety. Not only this, but this man's medical costs were paid for. They were paid for without condition. So subversive, so prophetic, so convicting is this message of Jesus here, that it is a message that calls all of us to drop everything, drop our ideas and ambitions and go and do the same thing. Drop our comfortability on the side of the road and go and do the same thing. Drop all the things that are stopping us from doing that exact same thing and going to help those in need. What a conviction for us. That perhaps there is a message here for us to learn about the perils of putting religiosity and tradition ahead of mercy and love. Perhaps there is something for us to learn here. Indeed, if we claim to be Christians, perhaps it means nothing if our deeds do not match our actions and our words. To me, this is fundamentally what changes the world. Absolutely. Radical acts of love and care. Giving people dignity once more. Humanizing the enemy. Humanizing people that are marginalized. Absolutely, that changes the world. And so John continues in 1 John 4, verse 16. He says this, God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. This is how love is made complete amongst us, that there is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. And whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or a sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen cannot love God who they have not seen. So friends, my sense here is that in this post-COVID world, where the sands are shifting and the rule book has been thrown out the door, that we have a unique opportunity to be reminded once more that our DNA lineage as light bearers in a new and exciting way to the world simply needs to be extravagantly more light that needs to shine. We're actually in a space of invitation where we can be called back to that once more, reminded again, we're called to be light bearers in a dark world. We're called to be people that light up the dark parts of our suburbs. Indeed, our world needs more good news stories rather than less. May I be so bold to suggest that our world needs less religiosity and more agape love from us and those that don't look like us. Our world, more than ever, needs a leader on a donkey, not a leader on a war horse. More than ever. Jesus threatened the comfortability of the religious and the powerful. Jesus, this homeless, prophetic, dangerous man, would call the deaf to life, the sick to health, the blind to sight. He would call the adulterous to a new life. The abandoned would be found. Jesus would call the lost to be invited in, to find a place at the table. The outcast to be included in abundantly, the disabled to be loved and found a place. It is this Jesus, friends, this image of Jesus, this image who calls all of us out of our own grave of stubbornness and laziness and self-importance and sin and into a new world of care and action and agape love. It is this Jesus who invites us into a new way of seeing the world, a kingdom not empire, of humility and not power, as hope and not despair, and to live as hope and not despair. It is this Jesus who requires us to pray for our enemies, pray for them, to see the new transformative power of the least and the few, to be bold enough and foolish enough to pray for the enemy soldier and the warmonger, to pray for our enemies. Now, that's a tough ask. To pray for Ukraine, to pray for Russia, to pray for soldiers in the Congo, to pray for the Taliban in Afghanistan. But that's what we are called to do, to be bold enough and foolish enough to believe that our prayers matter. Agape love, the gospel message, this is Jesus. Jesus calls upon us to be advocates for truth to power, justice in office, hope in humanity, and love in dangerous ways. These are things that are needed more than ever. For in a world of Trumps, Johnsons, Bolsonaros, Murdochs, we must press in harder, speak even louder, pray even greater, stand up even taller against the myths and dangerous lies of money, empire, and power and corruption. Agape love must be our footprint in the sand and in our neighborhood. So friends, four things for us today. May we actively practice agape abundance, not worldly scarcity. Think about the man on the Jericho road, scarcity. The Samaritan, agape abundance. Kingdom thinking, not empire. Number two, may we pray for people not like us, without condition. Without condition. Number three, may we practice agape love with people we agree with and people we don't agree with. People that don't deserve agape love. May we be bold enough to try that, friends. And lastly, may we be light bearers in the world and neighborhood with our words, actions, deeds, and prayers. May agape love spread. I want to finish with a song, one that I'm sure that we all know, and one that is, I'm sure, very dear and is connected to all of our faith stories. When we were up in Northeast Arnhem Land last year, I was able to witness firsthand the complexities of two cultures trying to live together in partnership. We stood on native title land. We stood on sacred land. We stood and walked and breathed on the same land as Barclays painting their stories for generations. This was the same land as Yothu Yindi. This is the same land as David Gulpilil and Jeffrey Gurumal. And when the gospel sings through culture, then we get to witness something extraordinary. When words like grace can have just as much power in Arnhem Land in 2022 as it did in Selma, Alabama in 65. Then it is truly a beautiful thing to sing Amazing Grace together. Jeffrey Gurumal, many of you may know him, he was a Yungul man. He was born on Elko Island. He grew up on a mission station. He taught himself how to play guitar. He was nominated for 9 ARIA awards and won 5 of them. The most remarkable thing, friends, is that he was completely blind. And yet, God blessed this man with extraordinary talent, extraordinary voice from the heart of culture. Gurumal understood spirit, land, creation, and the ways in which we are all connected as brothers and sisters. Many years ago, Gurumal recorded Amazing Grace with the ever wonderful and prophetic Paul Kelly. A powerful song, sung in 2 languages, English and Indigenous. God speaks over culture throughout generations and time. And so friends, may this song be a benediction, a reminder that we serve a powerful God of love, a powerful God of abundance, who is calling all people to Him. This is agape love. The gospel in action doesn't always look like us. Sometimes it looks like someone who's not me. But may we be light bearers along the Jericho road.